I'm Steven, and that's me running backwards with the camera. And that's my friend Joseph Newcomb. But let me rewind a little. Let me catch you up to speed. June 2015, I got a phone call from my friend Lencia Schuler. She'd been riding at Steffen Peter's barn for the last 10 years, but she was heading off to Germany for the next 3 months to ride two horses that she has in training over there. She asked me if I was interested in coming down to take over her business while she was away. Absolutely. I packed my bags, loaded my horses, and was on my way. I spent a total of 6 months down at Arroyo Del Mar. I made a lot of friends and met a lot of great people. But the most amazing thing was getting to watch Steffen ride and train his horses every single day. It changed my life. Me and my friend Joseph decided we wanted to do a little mini documentary to share with everybody some of the magnificence and beauty of what we were seeing every day. We asked Steffen, he was on board, so we sat down with him and asked him a few questions.
Showing a little bit our philosophy of dressage, which is showing expression with pure lightness, with self-carriage, with suppleness, and bringing this philosophy a little bit across, that we show expression but with the horses using their own muscles and not so much the rider's muscles. And I think that is the main philosophy of our training, that we really try to educate our horses to offer the movement, and every single movement or every single exercise that we talk about simply comes down to the pure acceptance of the aid. We look at aids that are hidden, and let's remember, we get a score for that. It's not just how we sit on our horses, but it's also clearly the effectiveness of our aids. And anything that we want to do with our horses, even if it's something like making a hind leg quicker, getting more engagement, getting more expression, it all comes down to the pure understanding of the aids. So many people always talk about the strength for dressage and how fit our horses have to be, and I totally agree with that. But let's remember for a moment, if we have a horse that's so clearly on the aid, clearly on the leg aid, and the horse offers the movement a bit more without the rider having to support with this maximum amount of strength, because of them performing the movement a bit more motivated and making it a bit more effortlessly looking. I think because of that, a horse can become stronger. It's not just repetitively going through movements and making a horse fit, but momentarily asking a horse to put maximum strength of the engagement in a piaf, in a passage, in a pirouette, putting that effort clearly into a moment for let's say 30 seconds, we really see a horse understanding the movement, and because of that, I think horses get stronger. Think about people who inspired me during my lifetime. First of all, it's mom and dad, who had a very busy work schedule, worked through late through Saturday afternoons in a clothing retail store that they owned, but they always made time available for my sister and myself to go to the shows. And I remember with the ponies that we started showing when we were 10 and 11 years old, and I think that was a huge benefit to start that early to get your nerves under control. By the time young riders came around at 16, 17, you had already so many national shows under your belt, where the focus was not influenced by being nervous. And I have to say, with my dad passing away after the 1996 Olympic Games, I still think, in any major show, I still think a lot about him, how amazing it would have been for him to witness this amazing achievement that I was able to get with his help. At the end of the day, he provided a three-year-old horse for me that competed in 1996 at the Olympic Games. So if I really have to narrow it down to one person who inspired me the most, it was clearly him, who was also physically very fit. Even a year before he passed away, he was still on his bike and did some strength training. And there was this incredible amount of discipline that I admired. And I knew if I wouldn't train hard, I knew if I wouldn't show that discipline, it would have been extremely disappointing to him. So we never had to talk a lot about, or we never had that conversation about him pushing me. I always had that desire to push myself. I still remember that day. I was doing a clinic at Akiko's place in Northern California, and this was in March of 2006. And after the clinic, I sat down with Akiko, and I'll never forget that. And she said, the next Olympic Games will be in China, and since we're Asian descent, we'd love to have a horse that can represent us there. And I'll never forget that moment. So immediately afterwards, I talked to a lot of friends and very well connected people in the dressage world in Europe, and the process started immediately after that. And it was till August of 2006, after looking at numerous videos, my friend Eugene Raising sent me this video of Ravel, and the changes were not confirmed, but I saw this elastic horse, this beautiful horse with this world-class canter, covering so much ground, but also being able to collect very easily. And right off the first second, I fell in love with him, and everything was finalized right around the World Games in Aachen in 2006. And absolutely no doubt, Edward Gall rode Ravel, starting the small tour at that time, and I was just amazed the first time when I rode this horse, and I knew that this would be the horse of a lifetime. When Ravel came into quarantine in 2006, things were extremely difficult. He turned into this crazy stallion after life breeding and wouldn't eat anymore, just was so worried about being a bit in isolation in quarantine. So I still remember one day where I stayed with him till 1 o'clock in the morning in quarantine, and he finally settled down, got a few hours of sleep, came back the next morning, and just getting there, he was already sweating, nervous, and it just took forever to get him to settle down. And once he came home, I still remember the first 4 weeks of riding him. Things started to improve, but he suffered this devastating injury which had the potential of being career ending. And I still remember how frustrated and how sad and how tough this was, because I had to call Akiko. I said, listen, I feel really bad for Ravel. Things were going good, but it looks like that he needs 8 months of hand walking. And, you know, thank God he settled down. And once he went back to work, it was now early 2008, and the Olympic trials started. He had never done a Grand Prix in his life, and I never forget the first CDI in Burbank, which was an Olympic qualifier. And he started with in the Grand Prix and the special over 70%, and from there it just got better and better. And I have to say, one of the toughest moments of my career was the Olympic Games in Beijing. The venue was in Hong Kong. It was an amazing facility, and the team competition, the Grand Prix only counted for the team competition, and the Grand Prix special and the freestyle counted for the individual medal. Ravel missed the bronze medal by 0.2%. And again, in those days, it was a score combined between the special and the freestyle. Ravel was third in the freestyle, but overall fourth, and he missed the bronze medal by 0.2%. And I didn't really want the... It sounds funny. Of course, I wanted the bronze medal, but I wanted the bronze medal to be on his record, and it just would have meant the world to me if I could have said Ravel won a bronze medal at the Olympic Games. It was 0.2%, and I think only Shannon knows how deeply that affected me afterwards. That's why when the 2010 World Games came around and Ravel had won the World Cup in 2009. But in 2010 we had another chance of hopefully getting close to the bronze medal. And when he won the bronze medal in Kentucky in 2010, I still remember the score. It was a 78.35%, and it is incredibly hard to describe how that felt, because it was such a... I was so proud of Ravel. I was so proud for our team, and for him to win a bronze medal for the United States was incredible.
Mocha Noana once said, Though you can love what you do not master, you cannot master what you do not love. It's obvious the love Steffen has towards his horses, and this permeates every aspect of his training. I'd often see him come back to the barn later at night just to give his horses a pat and some treats. I suppose the beautiful thing about this sport is it's not just about the horses you ride, but the people you meet along the way. Even though we spend hours alone toiling away in the arena, it's the community that gives it strength. Even though I'm now back in Canada, the friends and memories of Arroyo Del Mar will stay with me forever. I'm reminded of the most profound element in dressage, which is, as we change our horses through training, they, in effect, change us.
Like, at the end of the day, if you could boil it all down to, like, a smaller thing, like, what's the most important thing for you in your riding?
Just never, ever fuck up.
We got it. Nailed it.